And there is this theory that humanity began with black people, and it came out from Africa.
La presencia de negros africanos en la Mosquitia es de origen arcaico y misterioso. El Caribe nicaragüense fue un espacio deseado por piratas, aventureros y colonizadores. Posteriormente, se convierte en ruta de comercio. 1630. Llegan puritanos ingleses con miras de hacer negocios a una de las islas de la Mosquitia. La isla es bautizada por ellos con el nombre de Providencia. Los primeros británicos se establecen llevando negros africanos como esclavos en su mayoría. 3 años después, comerciantes ingleses consolidan una alianza comercial y militar con los indígenas táhuiras en contra de los españoles, quienes nunca logran entrar a la Mosquitia. ...1640... un buque portugués, el Newton, con esclavos amotinados en calla cerca de los Cayos Misquitos. Los esclavos nadaron hasta la costa. ...1655... el reino inglés se toma la Gran Jamaica, profundizando la colonización inglesa en el Caribe. Este hecho marca la parentela entre Jamaica y la costa caribe centroamericana. 1Aprovechando la guerra entre españoles e ingleses por el dominio de la región, esclavos negros huyen de la isla de Providencia. Llegan a la costa de la Mosquitia, donde se mezclan con los indígenas, creándose con el tiempo el grupo ancestral Misquito Africano.
In 90 years, Brisna. Took 10 Brisna. Big blue fill set in a balan. Mamiki well brain. Go amakan mamiki well brain. Taya ba 6 up here. No black, black man. Hair too. English. Miskuto. I see can. I see nani bawina waleri, I sari. I little hair. Kapiki work takikan in sila worka. Plun manas mangkikan. Manas. Bastante comida. Plata, siksa, banana, todo. La konara miskaya. Aida kakaya, pribalaya. Piyaya. Kinda oki mangkikan. Almok na ni plun kuk takibar, upla dakakikan, upla manas. BP kaya, dance pula ya, sut, sut, sut. Upla manas, dance pula ya. Wahamat yara, almok. Nisan. Yang simpuli ka pariban. Ay,
Pancho. black with Indian. And then come the Carib and the Creole blood that I have into me. My grandfather came from Jamaica, black. I'm black, and I love to have this color because it's very good color.
20, 30.
And my grandmother came from Wawa,
50, 60,
and then come live in Puerto 50. Cabeza. So then my mama come from Roanoke. She come here and then she meet up with my pop, and well, they make love, and that's how we mix Miskito and English and Spanish and Garifuna. Four come out. Because we speak Miskito, we speak English, and we speak Spanish. But we can't speak the Garifuna because, well, we live far from there, but I could say little water, Masintunaduna. That I could say, please give me little water.
Entre los siglos XVII y XIX existió el reino de la Mosquitia, territorio vasto en riquezas naturales, originalmente poblado por indígenas. Los misquitos se convierten en el grupo dominante por su alianza con los ingleses. La Mosquitia se transforma en protectorado británico coordinado desde Jamaica por las autoridades de la corona. En 1783, se firma el Tratado de Versalles y reconocen a España la soberanía sobre la Mosquitia. Sin embargo, el territorio siguió separado del resto de Centroamérica. El reino inglés traslada su presencia y poder a Belice. Los ingleses habían establecido varios asentamientos mixtos. En 1787, se ven obligados a salir de la Mosquitia debido a la ratificación del Tratado de Versalles. La intempestiva salida de los británicos brinda la oportunidad a que la mayoría de mulatos y esclavos queden en posesión de todos los bienes de sus amos, heredando lengua y costumbres, mezclándose con los indígenas del territorio de los Cucras. Años después, se autollaman creoles. El epicentro de esta identidad se da en Corn Island, Pearl Lagoon y Bluefields. Con el tiempo llegan más negros libres del Caribe y del sur de los Estados Unidos. En 1841, se da la liberación de todos los esclavos. Con la firma del Tratado de Managua en 1860, promovido por los Estados Unidos, el protectorado británico en la Mosquitia llega a su fin, delimitándose cuantiosamente su territorio. Durante 34 años, las comunidades de los Black Creoles y Miskitas vivieron en un régimen autonómico con el estatus de reserva.
It is in the time of the Mosquitia that you had many of the people that were part of the council were Afro descendants, and particularly were Creoles, and it is in that time that you see a lot of development here in the region. Trade with the United States, trade with Europe, trade with the Caribbean islands. We had our own money and our own coins. We had our own constitution. We had our own autonomy. And people in that time enjoyed a lot of rights as Afro-descendant people and as indigenous people.
Black people were behind the rey. They were handling the kingdom. They were ministers, they were counselors, they were helpers, they were leaders. You know, they had a strong role during this moment. Black people were also sent to study and to get prepared out of the country. They used to send them to Jamaica, they used to send them to the United States. So then when they came back, they were the most prepared to hold those important roles. During this moment also, they used to hold important roles as leaders of enterprises. They were owners of acerrios, they were whatever. You know, they had a lot of influence, you know, and it has to do with their preparation and their language.
I believe there was a forceful annexation of the Mosquitia to the rest of Nicaragua by means of arms and with the support of the United States Marines. In effect, we did not want to belong to the rest of Nicaragua. Primarily when the effects of belonging to the rest of Nicaragua after the Mosquitia was annexed to the rest of the country, there was an internal colonization of the Mosquitia and of the Caribbean coast in this case. And that meant that we began to lose our identity. English they stopped to teach in English in all the schools for more than 15 years. And we were forced to learn Spanish. And we were just treated as an area where people from the functionaries from the Pacific Coast of Nicaragua would come and take over our lands and our properties. I believe the annexation of the Caribbean coast to the rest of Nicaragua is the beginning of the new manifestations of racism here in our country and in the Americas.
And when it began over, the education then was in Spanish. And that is how they start with the process of castellanización. And it means we want to put all of you all in one sack, you know. And with this, they also affected the lifestyle, the self-government monarchy that was happening here. All of that gone in zero in one moment.
A finales del siglo XIX, y comienzos del siglo XX, se dan levantamientos armados encabezados por los creoles. Productores creoles e indígenas quedaban sin oportunidades ante el monopolio impuesto por el gobierno nacional y el capital norteamericano. Estos productores, inspirados en la Asociación de Negros Unidos por el Desarrollo, intentan irse a huelga. 1924. Representantes de grupos indígenas y líderes creoles escriben una carta al secretario de los Estados Unidos de América, liderados por el general George Hugson, padre del movimiento autónomo contemporáneo. La misiva reclamaba las enormes injusticias del estado de Nicaragua con los pobladores del Caribe. 1926. Debido a la corrupción del gobierno conservador y aprovechando las huelgas de los productores locales, el general George Hugson, junto a 25 bravos guerreros, encabeza una insurrección armada contra el gobierno de Nicaragua, la cual no favorecía los intereses de los Estados Unidos. Poco tiempo después, tropas norteamericanas intervienen en el país.
With the presence of these North American and Canadian companies, they came to establish enterprises that work with lumber, that work with the mining, with the gold itself, and that, you know, at some point gave a lot of work to the people them that were already established here, you know. So, okay, this company came, we had job flowing, we had to get up and work, but at a certain level, your money gone right back into the companies because they established what were known as commissaries, los comisariatos. You get your pay and everything used to go right back and stay right back into the company. These companies brought everything you could have think about. So then people thought, we assume at that moment that we were living good, that our people were living good. But when you make today the analysis of all of those social effects, you see that you wasn't living that good. You was getting your money, but it was going right back to the company. At some point, I could say, it affects us. Today, we're talking about a lot of people that are sick, that work in the mining company in those years, and that are not attended. You know, they got a lot of sickness due to going in into these deep caves and whatever, just trying to make the daily bread of every day. But today, nobody is looking how to attend that consequence.
Bluefields, lugar de encuentro de diferentes naciones indígenas. Fue parte del territorio de los Kukras. Cohabitada por piratas, comerciantes, británicos y otros europeos hasta el inicio del comercio de esclavos indígenas. Actualmente es la ciudad más multiétnica del país.
I see the people coming down, them coming to town from all around. By wings and canoe you can pass, people they like sun, what is going on? Them empty old bank and cotton tree, behold them pointing, look like it's all. Today is the day and we come to shine. One thing I will mind and we feeling fine. We getting down on Bluefields. Tell me how you feel. Because we need to sell it. See we getting down on Bluefields. Tell me how you feel.
Jason, bring the chocolate in, baby.
Let's see this one. Good? Okay, what we're going to do now, we're going to cook this for today, okay? So you carry it in the kitchen for me, okay?
I am a black Creole speaking person. I would say Creole mean we are Nicaraguan, we was being brought up speaking English. We speak it however we wanted it, just not in an American way, you know. We used to call children picnini, you know, and that's the way our old people used to call it, children. Picnini come here, that would mean that's my child, come here. The Creole culture is like when we keep maple, that's one. We have the way that we used to cook, you know, like we would cook ground food. Yuca, dashing, cocoa, and we would have like say coconut food, that is fish, oysters, and things like that. That's the way Creole people. Being I have 69 years, I feel like I could say much of the old time way. Today, you cannot do a favor for someone if you don't pay. I could tell you, in the old days, if I had this land and I don't have anywhere to stay, they would say, come on, build your house there until I die, you could stay. That's the way it was in old days, but today, no. First, we didn't used to have the kitchen. gather with the you know, being with the house in one. The kitchen was afar from the house. You know, we had a walkover. We call it walkover. Then you walk from the house to the kitchen. That's the way it was. That's the way it was. Yeah. We used to put the bungle on our head and go to the creek.
I'll be there, have joy with her to share.
Nutmeg, cinnamon, and white lime, and mix that, and set in a nappy, and pin that nappy on. Then you put on the panty or the boxer. Them used to tell them to go take up your bed and walk. You stay here no more, go to your home. And you know where them set you there with your resting place. Go and rest there. And used to talk to them. And I never see them go, but I hear them talk to them. You could start to sing from soon. But the nine night when you turn up the bed, well, you stop singing and do that, you have a special hymn that you use at that time. When 12 o'clock, they would sing, "Sleep on, beloved, sleep and take thy rest." And then them do everything and you go back out and to your table, you sing again till daylight if you don't want. I tell you, fold up the sheets, then take off everything and take off the pillowcase and fold them up, lay them in the turn the mattress up and lay everything there. You take down your curtains to now, fold up everything and put together. Next day, when you look at that, they really look dead.
We love it, not fear.
A little while.
A little while.
Sin shall dwell.
Always sin shall dwell.
Hallow union.
In hallow union.
Indivisible.
Indivisible.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.
First, everybody used to sing. Afterward, churches began to kick against it and put you on discipline, and well, then it stopped. But here it stopped, but you go somewhere, you know, stop all like Boca San Andres, but them sing from you dead. Sometimes I hear the spirit, them afraid of it. But I always say I'm afraid of the living more than I'm afraid of the dead. The dead is gone. Sleep on, beloved. Sleep and take your rest. Lay down thy head upon your Savior's breast. We loved you well, but Jesus loved you best. Good night, good night, good night.
I can remember when I used to watch Kitiali, there was a lady by the name of Ayuna Alvarez. She passed away many, many years. She passed away now like 50 odd years. Yes, I learned that from them. So I just continued then on watching, and I get to learn it. So then I being the head now. So I being the captain now, and I continuing. So now what I'm doing now is showing the rest what it's like.
My young days, I had a great aunt. She was over 100 years, propped up in her bed.
I want you to know why we celebrate Maypole. When I was a young girl, knew that the Maypole was celebrated for a fertility, with fertility. Don't ever forget about this. Our tradition is a Maypole, which ladies dance first around this tree. This tree never bear fruit. That's the reason it is chosen, because they are celebrating fertility. The fertility. Don't forget that. The Maypole dance is a fertility dance. What do they dance around it? They use the mento music from Jamaica. They dance loose. They don't hold a partner. they dance for themselves, any figure.
When I look and I remember the first lyric that they surround the tree with, the ladies, is Maya Yala Siki, Maya Yahu. And I look, and the Mayaya, they say Mayaya, but the Mayaya, as I search and search and found out, that's the goddess of May, the goddess of fertility. So that is what our people were presenting, but they did not know.
I don't want you to forget our tradition. Please do what you can to keep this tradition among our people.
Boy, that's the piece, that's the blues. I wanted to teach them our ballroom dances of our ancestors. So I started teaching them the waltz. The shatis come from, shatis is mostly from Poland, I think.
One, two, three, four. Pam 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 pam.
Then they had three clubs. They had one they called the Eight Brothers. That was a group of men. They had a white hat with a little eight on it. Had rock'n'roll those times. It was rock'n'roll. And they played music. And then you will take out your partner and dance. And after you done dance with your partner, they will say, now you're going to treat your partner. Then you would just carry her to the counter and ask her what she want. And there had been so much things to sell that she would just ask if she want food, if she want soup, if she want chicken, if she want rondon, if she want ice cream, if she want soda cake, if she want cocoa cake, if she want toto, if she want bread pudding cake, if she want cassava cake, any kind of cake she asked for, she will get. Plenty of the women them that really didn't have a husband, and when they go to these social now, they would always carry a little pot or a pan or something container, and they would give it to the lady that take care of the selling of the food. They would tell her, just put it in my pan. No? Maybe she get two or three dance, she get two or three treats. So she put it in her pan, and a little later, she sent it home to our children to take supper.
Popular as Popo. Anyway, I go Popo here, Popo there, Popo here, Popo. But I don't make that reach my head. I make it reach my heart so I could learn to love people more. Because after you make fame reach your head, you end up doing nothing. Yeah, the most population in this neighborhood is young people. Because you see, you have a lot of young boys and girls that just coming up in the teenage, like 13 and 14, 15, 16, and then they're coming up in the same environment that they see around. You know, so it's like, it's very sad to know that it's like we're there with our hands tied and we don't have nowhere out to help these young children them. For example, you have a lot of children, again, boys and girls, that is graduating out of school from sixth grade, from preschool, from fifth year. And after that, it's just that. It's just you get a diploma, you come out of school, no work, nothing to do, nothing to keep your mind busy with. So the only thing is what you see to do is lead yourself towards where the others are.
I was 21 and I was working as a secretary, you know, and well, it wasn't that good for me, you know. I had another goal, so I decided to go and work and ship and see if I could make a better living. My dream was to be a actress. If I had to turn back the time, I would have liked to be a actress. Go to the university, study, and help to bring up my community. I was very easy, I was very soft. I used to cry for everything, but ship made me change a lot. Yeah, make me become a stronger person, more firm, and, you know, to look forward and, like, you know, really know what I want in life.
If we sit here, we can't help. So they go and send that money monthly to the parents. And then we used to helping each other. You know, I get my money. For instance, I get my money, I help my daughter. My daughter help her child at least to get an education. And that's the way it is. You're sad to go, but at the next hand, you're happy to be there when you start getting paid.
The major problem that we have in here in our black community, in our black barrio, which it would be Old Bang, Beholding, Pointeen, Cutting Tree, you know, is the drugs. That is the biggest problem we face in here right now, the drugs. And it's something that is like a time bomb. It's just that you don't know where it's going to start from and where it's going to end. I was a woman that first in this barrio, for me, everybody used to deal drugs. We used to say it for surviving. I was one that used to sell drugs. I was in a board house. I was in a house that I'm not ashamed to say, you could have stayed from outside and see me inside. And I used to deal drugs. I had my oldest son. That was my first son, and he was something like 4 to 5 years old. And I didn't put in mind to it to know that my child was noticing what I was doing. Until one time he come to a vacation time, and I sent him to Pearl Lagoon to pass vacation with his grandfather. And he went and he told his grandfather what I was doing here. My father-in-law come from Pearl Lagoon, and he sit down with me and show me the different scriptures of the Bible, and show me what you sow, you reap, you know. And I said, I myself make up my mind and say, I don't want to pay for it whilst I living worse when I'm dead. And I make up my mind and decide to just stop sell drugs. And here I am now. Here I am with my self-esteem very high. With respect anywhere I go, everybody's Miss Popo, Miss Popo, Miss Popo. To get respect, you have to give respect. And I am not criticizing who's still selling drugs, but I just want to give them a wake-up call. That's not the only way of surviving in life.
Hey, Cause no for them no see the way we live the life down here. And if them see it look to me as if they just don't care. Like them not tired, see we suffer like them one if it disappear. No matter how we all and how it look like them don't care.
Sometimes they ask me if I'm really happy now. I say sure, I never love her anyhow. But inside I'm longing for you and the way it used to be. I look around and there's a heartache following me. I always say that I'm really glad you're gone. I even act like I never care at all. But each memory's lingering there, and I'm never really free. I look around, and there's a heartache following me.
Well, I grew up with a mother and a father. Was married for, how long you married, Pop?
61.
Married for 61 years and raised 10 kids. We come from a very poor family. But we had all about life, except money. My father taught us all how to work. All of us can fish, we can plant, and we can build. That is all from my father. He always said that not all of us did happen to finish school. If we wanted it, we definitely could have gotten it, but it come to a time that we just walk away. And I want to be home. I want to be home more to be able to do more with my people.
So we work by season. When the time to fish, we fish. When time to plant grain, we plant grain. My father plant coconuts and teach us how to plant the coconut. So when we, as she said, we live but not with a lot of money.
My father, he can tell you, he would produce 85% of the daily food we was eating. He would plant it and have it there in stock because he knew he had his kids to feed. And whoever listening to this tape, please understand that one of the first education you should have is from your house. Have a house education, you should be able to learn to cook and plant because that is real life. Whatever you're learning, that is technology. It will work, but when that day come down, it's come down to one life. You gotta get back to earth to live.
Come see, Rico. Jump early.
And this place, we have trees. We have coconut trees that have approximately 85, mango trees that have 85 years. And we have coconut trees that my grandpa planted. We have coconut trees that I plant. And now we're gonna get coconut trees that my son plant.
What I have earned from the soil, it was so useful to support my wife and children until they became men and women. And so my children, they have other trade, but we always stick to the to the farm.
Hey, yo! Padre!
Corn Island was first inhabited by the Kupra Indians. They were short with chubby looks and flat faces, and they would have the ears and nose pierced. And they would seldom come and go from the island in their little dories, as we would call it. The Miskito Indians drive them away eventually, along with the pirates that came to the island to get water and whatever they could find and from the island to steal.
This is my mother and my father. His name is Jeremiah Tucker, and her name was Gladys Quinn. They were both born on Kern Island, and it goes way back, you know? Her ancestor came here to Kern Island in the early 17th century, and they were English. And when they came to Kern Island, unfortunately, he was a pirate. And his name was Kirkpatrick Quinn. And then he married the chief daughter. So she was the princess. And he changes her name because she had an Indian name. And then he changes her name to Emilia. And that was all started. Then he came to the island. And when he came, he brought different family with him.
1787. It was found on Corn Island. There was a man by a slave owner, to be frank, by the name of Robert Hudson. He was found residing here on Corn Island with 142 slaves. With these slaves, he also had corn field and cane field also. And cotton, especially cotton. He would send to Liverpool, England to exchange for different items.
Life was very simple, but happy. Very happy life, you know? Can you imagine? I knew nothing about the TV on Kern Island. I knew nothing about the radio, because we grew up without a radio, without a TV. And yeah, so it was simple. Oh, I remember my uncle and granduncle, they used to play the guitar. That was one of the tradition here, music. Everyone did their guitar, mandolin, banjo, violin, piano, organ, they had it all on Kern Island. Can you imagine now we don't even have that?
If I had to trace my roots, I wouldn't know where to start. My grandfather is from Jamaica, and that's from father's side. My grandmother descended from the United States, that's from father's side, and then from mother's side, my grandmother is Colombian and my grandfather Irish, so where do I start? But, I identify with the black race and obviously I'm Caribbean, I'm from Corn Island.
But when Sonia get up, what happened?
She never see her mama.
You have in black blood, which we would say Negro blood. You have in also British blood. You have in Indian blood. And with all of those mixtures, we would say it's come right down to being a Creole.
I was about 14 years when I started working. And I started on a farm that my father had on the San Juan River. And I did that for many years. Between time, I went to Managua to school, and then later on, I came back to the island. We migrated back to the island from the San Juan River. And by this time, the fishing had started. And I don't know that I'm one of the most important, but maybe one of the most consistent fishermen. I started as an artisanal fisherman, and there was a lot of product at that time, and most of the fishermen were satisfied to go out, you know, once or twice a week. I wanted to fish every day. So I said I wasn't the best fisherman, but maybe one of the most consistent. And obviously I was focused a lot on producing. And I save some of the money. Some I do like what any other fisherman does. But some I save and reinvested in the business. And over the years, I built a fleet of boats, and then decades later, I bought my first plant, and so I just kind of went on that way. It's a process of about 50 years, so.
My body's trembling, my heart just keeps a beat. I cry down my tears, without you I kind of sleep. Your memories on my pillow.
Thank you.
forest was practically like un caserío. There was just like one little neighborhood, if you want to call it neighborhood in those times, that was Cocal. There were a lot of bush around the place. There were a lot of, you know, trees, you know, of different and different fruits, yeah, but the population was very, very small. We can't forget that this place began after the 1920 to really, really, you know, arise as a city. And it was founded as a city in 1926. Black people that came into this population, into this society of Port, that came from different Caribbean countries. Among these, we can mention Belize, Grand Cayman, we can mention the Antillas, we can mention also people that came from Bluefields, Corn Island, Pearl Lagoon, and they came into Port during the 1920s. That was when the companies them were arising on this territory and were offering jobs for the population here. You know, people used to come to the center, do their transaction, their commercial transaction, and immediately return back to their community. You know, today, thing is different. Nobody returns back community. Everybody stations in port. And that is why the population has grown so much. About my identity is to accept all of my African ancestry, all of my African heritage. I am 100% black woman, you know, very proud to say that, you know.
My father and mother are a mixture of black and white, but my father also, we can trace some of our origins to the Ramas, which is an indigenous group here. So in effect, I could say I am a mixture of black, white, and Rama. But I consider my ethnic group, the group in which I survived, I lived, and I have developed myself as the Creole ethnic group. And that is the one that defines my identity.
We don't know really what Creole means. You know, we don't know who gave us that word. It just came out so, and we adapt it. Being called and being recognized as black is to accept from where you come.
Yeah, we use the word Creole because of the language what we talk. But we are black people. We are black people. And far as I know, and my parents make me to understand, there is a lot of people say, we all black people are African, but I don't count myself as African. I count myself as a Nicaragua black soil.
I identify myself as a black lady.
Today, to not offend no one, what we do is just assume the two terms. And we said black Creole.
I have to say that the autonomy process, at least for me, it was almost like a recognition of our history. I know that it helped to stop a conflict that was going on, an armed conflict, even an armed conflict among our own people. And in that respect, I think it has been, it is very good. One of the most consulted laws in the history of Nicaragua. It was consulted locally, in the communities, regionally. It was consulted nationally and internationally. When that autonomy law was approved by the National Assembly of Nicaragua in 1987, it does mean recognition of the rights of indigenous people and Afro-descendant people and mestizos here from the Caribbean coast. The autonomy continues to be one of our major aspirations.
Autonomy for me is something very important. Very, very important.
Eyota, what are you doing, Baba Dido? What are you
doing? I would really like us to get our autonomy because I feel like that's the way that we would survive the best, that we would build our country the best. But I don't think we're going to get autonomy right now. Because according to the bylaws that the autonomy law have in, we falter a lot of things to reach there. So for me, for us to get autonomy, we would have to have the judge that can talk our language, the police that can understand our language, and all the other institutions them should have somebody in there that can talk the language of the Creole black-speaking people. And unless that happened, we would never, never have autonomy here. Remember, some of us have been discriminated, DJ, by our own people. Maybe we own family. Maybe in our own home, the children them had been discriminated by parents, the community people them. You had one time people from Pearl Lagoon, people from Orinoco, people from Tasmapony, people from all the different communities, the scares are coming to Bluefields. Why? Because Bluefields people used to feel like because we live Bluefields, we in the city, we know all and we do our best.
Bamba was the child.
In the history of the Afro-descendant people, when they were captured from Africa and brought here to the Americas, it is the first time that that you are slaves because you are things. You are not human beings. Now, that has a serious effect on the minds of our people, and it still has its consequences now.
Because then the Creole society, known as Creoles, used to practically put the black people there on a lower scale. You know, if you are recognized as black, that means you are still a slave and you have to serve me. There are a lot of Creole families that own black people as slaves during our history. A lot of people don't know about that. So we ourselves used to buy our own people and use and abuse of them somehow, you know. And today with a lot of process that came in during the Sandinista revolution, I have to say, it's when maybe people start to talk about our different identities, our different cultures, and that is how, well, you start taking like more important as who you are.
Look at you, never mind the things they
they put you through. Never mind the way they set things up, to make sure you never get on top. Every attempt at progress them stop. Situation always get hot, because we got to move from the plot, just to get some food for the pot. Some of them you them want us free, but we know say life not free. Contemplate my reality, the system got nothing for we but one.
I came from Bluefields and Ethel May. But before I had made a trip to come to Carnival to visit the place. And when I came, I liked the place because it resembled Bluefields a lot. And I fell in love with Limon. So I said, I'll come back. But in those days, time was hard in Bluefields. And I had 10 children to look after.
All right.
Well, I came and started work, but I never wanted to work directly for people, but I had to do a start. Cleaning hotel and clean out the room with a Chinese lady. She treated me very good. But I worked very hard because I had to go in the morning with water. Sometimes when you tear it rain, it flood. The water come up and I walk with water to that just to go to work. But I wanted to do my things the right way.
This too big here.
I used to always think big. I think I'm going to get something worthwhile in this country. Because I said, working, I know you can do it. I'm not lazy. I'm a worker. From small, I've been working. And then I start to work hard for that, to get what my mind tell me I have to get.
And I think this watch need I don't know if that can fix or you have to put in a next watch.
Before I get the Black Star Line, I had a soda. Taylor's Caribbean Soda, the name. I give it name that. And that soda was there helping me tell my husband buy the rights of the Black Star Line. I tell my children every day, I say, if you want to work, you will live. But you have to work good. And the next thing, you have to be earnest. You have to be earnest to work with people. And that is how I live in this country. No, when the people from here see you start to make a little lift, they don't feel too good. They feel like, say, the Nicaraguan woman come to live off the country, their country, because they feel like Limon is theirs. They say, oh, look at she come and making living. Everybody said that. And they go take over. We had two soda, and they say, them going to soon take over Limon. But it's not that. It's just living and working.
You never mind the way they look at you. You never mind the things they put you through. You never mind the way they set things up, to make sure you never get on top. Every attempt at progress, them stop. A situation always get hot, because we got to move round the clock, just to get some food for the pot. Some of them you them want go free, and but we know say life not free. Some of them why high category, throw them those out, let's find we but one. Oh, Babylon.
I think it's one community divided by a borderline. So to me, it's a one community and it's family because, for example, us, they say that you have a lot of Dixon in Nicaragua that I don't know. And my uncle used to say we have to be family because when we came out Africa, and we spread out to Brazil and then to the Caribbean. When we leave Africa divided because the master made a good job in us. They sent the fathers that side, they sent mothers that side, and they divided all the children. So the old family spread out in Central America. So you could go to Nicaragua, you find a Dixon, or
You could go to Panama, you find Dixon. You go to Salvador, only Salvador you have a little black. But you go to Honduras, red body garifanas, because anywhere you go, you see somebody look like you. You know, so sometimes you wonder, aren't we family?
I was in Bluefields that we couldn't go to school because they was afraid of the Spanish people. We, most of our parents was from Bluefields. They used to work on the banana boat them. They used to come here every week. They used to be here. So it was more comfortable for them to bring over the family here. My father used to work on a boat, used to bring turkey by the hundred. So we that's how we came here.
Well, the black population of Central America developed the Atlantic coast. We built the railroad. We developed the banana, which was the product for this country. We developed coconut and the coffee also. And we developed the place by doing the building, because all the different ethnic groups that came here could not resist the weather, right? Because there was a big difference between the blacks and the whites, because our elderly people used to plant all the different herbs that they use today for the medicine. So our health was always protected by our elderly people. So I feel that the blacks have developed the Atlantic coast along the whole Central America, because wherever you go, you see black people, right? But before us, who were here could not develop as us. Today, we have not got the reward as being the developers of the Atlantic coast. And as in the old world, black people don't get thanks for what we have done. Well, the values is what have us survive until today, right? Because our people believe in, first, religion, right? The church has played a wonderful job in all the families that make me survive today. Because living in the Atlantic coast is not so easy for no family at all.
I used to work in San Jose, in the capital of our country, for 7 years. And my mom always told me, Kendall, sit on in front of the bus. Don't sit on the back side of the bus. Because in the beginning of the days, black people was not allowed to sit on the front of the bus. In the beginning of the days. Racism still here in Costa Rica. They still don't like us, you see. In my personal opinion, they always talk about, you are drugs dealer, you are you smoke weed, you hit your mom, do all stuff beside my hair. That's why I grow dreadlocks, but this is my personality.
And then another value is education. If you had money or you don't have money, you study. And children, first time, sometimes today it's differing a little, but first time you go to church and you go to school. There is no question there. You don't question if you go to school or you go to church.
The day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made, we will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. Oh, this is the day that the Lord has made, we will rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, this is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made.
Church, like Isaiah, we must continue even more than before to bend our knee. Not just for one day, not just for one evening, but as Isaiah said, I will continue to bend the knee until I see changes coming, until I see God's people restored, until I see God's nation restored.
My dad is a Nicaraguan. He lives in Bluefield, Nicaragua. And my mommy is a Costa Rican woman. I know some things about Nicaragua already, like the language, like Creole. In Costa Rica, we speak Creole, although some people say that it's Mecatelio. We know that it's Creole. And the link with Nicaragua has always been big. The autonomy law that I saw in Nicaragua and the Caribbean coast, it drew my attention because that has all the elements that the people in those areas need. It has about health, it has about education, it has about economic, and it has also about owners of lands. So I think these are specific ways that people has get together because of their need, and this is where we say human right is respected.
Donovan. Yes, yes. Look at the cuckoo, look at the cuckoo, look at the cuckoo. Yes, yes. Sit down. Where are these? Where are these?
They are inside here.
Where?
Yes,
sir. Ah, yes, but faltan la chompipa. Faltan la chompipa. Which one then?
So for me, Nicaragua is like my second home because it's where my dad lives and it's there where my offspring come from my daddy's side. As I walk along the water stream, I feel like somewhere he's seeing me, somewhere I'm being in contact with him because he loves to go fishing. And I know he loves the ocean a lot, so I knew that by some reason, whatever, he would be somewhere in the ocean and I would be this side on the ocean. So I feel like that was a common way to be in touch with him.
I was raised by the waterside people in the waterside where the Bahia is. I live that side. So we always have dory and we go out in the Bahia and paddle and go out fishing. And sometimes we go out bluff too. And but I like that because we go on the bay and we throw line and catch fish. That was most of our living down there. But I love that. I love the way we live in Bluefields. I love that. But I just have to give up that to come here.
Limón is full of a lot of people from Bluefields. And although they're living Limón for years, at least my grandmom, she will be 96 years old in April, if God spare her life. And she still, when she refers to Bluefields, she say home. She say home. And my mother-in-law, she said home too. So there always been a link. Although they are here for so many years, they still feel like home is back there in Bluefield. So living with parents like these, and even in, living in Costa Rica, we have learned to love the culture. We live with it because we eat the food that they prepare, and so it become like part of Nicaragua here in Costa Rica.
One of the main characteristics of the Creoles is their sense of happiness, their sense of community, and their sense of well-being. We are people who give a lot of importance to the education of our children, and we are prepared to make sacrifices so that our children can develop in a better world.
He said, and if you all permit me to repeat it in Creole, I would say it in Creole. Popo is popo, puna is puna, and emo is emo. And that make me feel proud. Because that have a big meaning. I can't be you and you can't be me. Me is me, and I gonna remain being purple until God ready for me.
I like everything. To be honest, I like everything. Mom always used to let us know, feel good of who you are. Don't make nobody feel better than you. Don't care who they are. That was my mom's word. And I feel that that's staying to me to be the person I am today. You can be who you are. I respect you, but I need you also to respect me.